Hello, Malty. Maladies, meandering morbidities. And thank you to Kodiak the Juggler for providing a malt mention for Ralfy Review 858 extras. Got a wee malt poured, Aran 10-year-old, delicious stuff. I'll have a wee sip as I'm giving you this presentation. This presentation is to do with strategic purchasing. How to make better use of your whisky budget for the year 2021. And basically to help you with yours, I'm going to tell you how I'm going to do mine. I have, fortunately, being an online reviewer and getting Google Adsense and support from my Patreon subscribers and my patreon.com channel, I'm in a fortunate position where I have a bigger budget, but that doesn't just simply give me extra money for buying more expensive older whiskies, particularly if they're not particularly good quality. I have taken a chance and a punt in the past with some 21, 25 year old whiskies, and they've been very nice, but frankly I don't think they're worth the money. One of the situations we have here, it's not so much that whiskey's getting more and more expensive. Some whiskey is. It's just that our spending power and the value of our currencies are getting weaker and have been getting weaker for quite a long time now, except that it happens at such a pace that we don't really notice it. It's called the general cost of living. Also, the fact that good quality liquor, which has come from Scotland and France and the US and Canada and European countries, you're now getting good quality liquor. Traditionally it would come from these industrialized countries, but now you're getting good quality liquor coming from all over the world. So you're getting good quality liquor from Mexico, some of the rum's amazing, some great mezcals, and some really good corn whiskey now. In fact, in Mexico, they're producing bourbon. Just so as you know, I notice in Eastern European countries like Bulgaria and Romania, you're getting some very interesting brandies appearing now. And countries that are in the developing, I mean, another example, of course, is Russia, where you're getting some fabulous quality vodka now, which used to be only available in Russia, but now is in the international market and available to us all to buy. And a good example is Russian Standard. It's a great vodka. It absolutely kicks Smirnoff into touch, which is kind of fairly generic British vodka. Very competent, but lacking in character. Because it's not designed to have character. It's designed to be neutral, really neutral. But proper vodka isn't really neutral. So I'm looking at the variety of what's out there, and I realise I've got to control my budget in such a way that I can buy a better quality bunch of spirits and avoid misspending my money on inferior spirits. Now, here's the components you've got to take into account. Marketing and advertising. You've got to disconnect from that. And one of the most insidious marketing tools now is where online influencers are influenced by marketing professionals who reach out to them to connect and support them. And that's fine to a certain extent. But marketing people are paid to do a job, and their job is to sell the product, period. If they're not doing that, they're not doing the job. And every commentator needs to be aware of the reality of the relationship and respect it. So you've got to be careful about even the marks and opinions and perspectives of onliners, even people like myself. Bear in mind, when I am reviewing a whiskey, I've bought that bottle where I am. It is not necessarily the same batch that you're buying in your country where you are. You may have a different batch using different casks, except it's the same bottle, same label. Maybe the strength's just a little bit higher, but there's very, very little difference between them superficially. This idea that batches are consistent in whiskey is simply not the case. It's more the case in blended whiskies, but ultimately a blender in a single malt distillery can only work with the casks they've got. And if you're aware of which distilleries invest more in their cask policies, that is a very serious piece of valuable knowledge to know when it comes to buying your whiskies. So, for example, Springbank. Glen Scotia, major cask investment in Glen Scotia recently, and it's really showing in their product. Good casks allow the flavour from the stills and the character and signature of a single malt to blossom, to become more expressive. This is also helped by any brands who bottle natural colour, unchill filtered, and higher than minimal strength. Always a good sign. If you've got the difference, if you're making your purchase decision and you see two bottles, one's bottled at 46%, the other 40%, let the 46% sway you. You're automatically getting more flavour. Nobody can argue with me in that. It's not up for discussion. That is a hard fact. More alcohol strength, more flavour, because the alcohol's there to carry the flavour that's there. Watch out for discounts or whiskey of the month or special promotional offers where you get a fancier container and you get a couple of glasses in it. That's fine for presents and New Year and maybe a birthday or so, particularly for less experienced people. But what you can find is that you're paying quite a hefty premium for additional packaging, which you're going to waste anyway, unless it's particularly inventively done, like the Ardbeg warehouse tin, which is the sort of thing you can store stuff in your little whiskey bothy, and you can keep because it looks good, and it's got a bit of substance to it and character. Have a look at older aged whiskies, but be careful about the name of the single malt. For example, if it's Highland Park or Bowmore, Laphroaig, Mortlach now and again, or some obscure distillery that we've not seen much of for a long time, like Northport, if there's any of that even still out there. What you'll find is these get premiumised, and for the independent bottlers to get some Ardbeg or Bowmore, they've actually got to pay quite a hefty premium from the person selling them the casks, so they get the opportunity to bottle it. And that's what really can account for the hefty price tag, because people are selling the label, the name on the cask. And you've got to make the decision, you know, is that whiskey going to be particularly good? Is it going to be a good version? Is it worth the premium? Or should I go back to an official bottling? That maybe it's a style of that particular distillery that I'm more familiar with and more comfortable with. Another thing you want to do is get pen and paper in the list. You get your pen, get a paper in the list, and you say, okay, dokie, righto, last year, here's a list of the whiskies I enjoyed when I bought them. Arden, Springbank, Ardbeg. Independent bottlers who are really quite like, well, your Signatory. But the thing is, with independent bottlers, they can have good versions of certain single malts and poor versions of other single malts. You might look at an independent bottler and you'd see Strathmill, but it's not a great signature. In fact, far from it. You might see Imperial, and you'd think, what the hell is that? Never seen that before. Imperial, I didn't even know there was an Imperial distillery. But you do your research and you see it's got a light, space-sidey signature. It's a light whiskey, and these whiskies can have amazing character. There's nothing finer than when you've got your list and you've covered the whiskies you already know and are purchasing again, but you want a completely different experience, so you're going to take a calculated risk and buy a style of whiskey or a name of a single malt you've never had before, like Imperial. Another good example, Tam na Vuolan. Another good example, let me see now, Binrinis. Another good example. That you, you do maybe have the official bottlings, but they tend to be sanitized slightly to appeal to a wider market who won't recognize the distillery name immediately. That's just looking after business. But when you get an eccentric version, Mortlach's on a great example, you can get a whole new flavor and smell experience which recalibrates your palate. And you look at last year's, the whiskies you bought and enjoyed, and you've got them down, many of them, for this year to rebuy again because you know they're good bets. But also, you want to move your own palate on a little bit. So it's doing the systematic research to make sure you don't waste your money. Certain independent bottlers are more expensive than others. Adelphi is an expensive independent bottler now because they had, up until recently, to a certain extent still do, some amazing quality of casks with some older single malts which really got noticed in the radar. And there's other independent bottlers where they're not so available and accessible mainstream, but you can get some really, really interesting versions of single malts. But you've got to go to certain shops that are just harder to access. Good examples, Cadenheads. Another independent bottler, Scotch Malt Whisky Society, who have recently been bottling younger and younger stuff, fresher and a little bit hotter, with less time in the casks. And people are saying, well, hang about, you know, where's these sparkling stars that we used to be able to buy? And any independent bottler can only go with the stock they've got. That's the fact of it. If they ain't got it to sell, so sad, too bad, they've got to find something else because they've got bills to pay and wages to pay and a brand to keep visible. So have a look at independent bottlers individually. What are the trends within these bottlers? What are the good versions of single malts that they tend to put out? What are the inferior versions of single malts that they tend to put out? And also, finally, look out for the unexpected surprises. Certain brands that appear in the market suddenly without any explanation and you know nothing about them. Particularly when a new distillery is launching or a new independent bottler, they want to get noticed, so they're going to bottle their best casks. So people say, oh, I bought that. You've never heard of it. Electric Cow or something, you know. It's a daft name, but, you know, it's the sign of the times. And it's a distillery that I've not really heard of. It's not so visible, but I tell you what, it's very, very tasty stuff. So you buy a couple of bottles of that. You never saw it coming. It's a spontaneous purchase, but it's done with calculation. So it was never on your list, and you know you're unlikely to buy it again. It's one of these one-off purchases, because it's just one of these, a few lucky casks that quickly appear in the market, and then when they're gone, they're totally gone. They'll replace by something else, but will it be as good? Hard to say. Those malt mates who play the malt chess game, the strategic moves of careful purchasing through one retailer rather than another retailer because of level of service and the quality of advice given, this all adds up. And particularly over time, as one gets more experienced, you will find that the success of your purchasing decisions becomes more and more positive, and you continue to have that golden glow moment enjoying your whiskies, saying, I'm glad I bought that and that and that. I've not made a bad purchase this year. Unlike people who are a little bit more haphazard, who have maybe spent quite a lot of money and been disappointed with a whisky and spend half the time going through the bottle pretending they're not disappointing with the whisky and trying to convince themselves that the quality of the whisky is great and it must be their palate. No, it's probably the quality of the whisky. My advice is, it's hard to find a really bad whiskey. But what's far, far worse than a bad whiskey? Because bad whiskies are easy to spot. Are these bland whiskies, these characterless, featureless whiskies that have kind of faded in the cask over time, that are not memorable, that basically a comfortable experience. They're palatable, but they're forgettable. Whiskey's not supposed to be forgettable unless it's a blend that goes in with ice and tonic and soda, or Coca-Cola, or ginger and whatever, or goes into some damn cocktail. I never ever buy whiskey cocktails, and I rarely make them, just for the record. These folk, they're going to have that. The disappointment isn't isolation, because one disappointment tends to be followed by another, and it just basically sours the whole experience. With whiskey, it really, really pays to do the groundwork, to do your apprenticeship and learn your craft. Just as a cooper has to do their apprenticeship, and a distiller has to do their apprenticeship, the buyer has to do the apprenticeship, the malt mates and the whiskey drinkers. And as the way it is, I'd love to just basically hand it to you in a plate, but hey, it's your journey, not mine. I can tell you my journey and hopefully it will help you with yours, and that's about it. Anyway, thank you very much. If you haven't subscribed, please do. You can also follow me for extra content in Patreon under Ralfy, R-A-L-F-Y. And also, if you're interested, I do have another channel, my practical philosophy channel called Fitter Philosophy. There's a link down below in the description box. So pop along and visit me there, where I've separated my life opinions from the whiskey channel completely, so that on the whiskey channel I focus purely on whiskey, generally keeping it positive, but not always, particularly when I feel that I'm getting messed about. It's real life. I'm Ralfy. This is the Clivey Clicker, still in the Bothy, in the new year. New jacket. I hope you like my new jacket. Here, I'll give you a wee swatch with the green. Oh, look at that green tartan. It's very cosy. I'm Ralfy from the Bothy, pressing the Clivey Clicker to say goodbye. Bye-bye.